असं कसं काय?
रचना रानडे हेअर अँड आय वेलकम यू ऑल टू अन आयपीओ रिव्ह्यू ऑफ पारस डिफेन्स अँड स्पेस टेक्नॉलॉजीज लिमिटेड. ओ माय गॉड, आय एम डुईंग अन आयपीओ रिव्ह्यू आफ्टर सच अ लॉंग टाइम, फील्स गुड. वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट सो मेनी पॉइंट्स अबाउट द आयपीओ. वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट द कंपनी अनालिसिस, वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट द इंडस्ट्री अनालिसिस, वेदर गव्हर्नमेंट इज टेकिंग एनी स्पेसिफिक इनिशिएटिव्स फॉर दिस सेक्टर ऑर नॉट, अँड मेनी मोर पॉइंट्स कमिंग अप इन द कमिंग पार्ट्स ऑफ द व्हिडिओ. As usual, let's start by understanding what does the company do, right? The company is into designing, then developing, manufacturing and testing of what? Defense and space related equipments. Now, if I were to go a shade into detail, you can also understand that it caters to four major segments of the defense sector. Which four major segments? Number one, it's into defense and space optics. It's into defense electronics. It's into electric or electromagnetic pulse protection solutions. My God. And it's also into heavy engineering. And I'm sure you have understood nothing. So let's understand with simple examples, simple explanations about each and every point one by one. So let's have a look at these pictures and try and understand what does the company do in easy words, right? So first you can see the picture is about infrared lenses and they are used for thermal imaging. Simple point is night vision cameras. So basically cameras which can capture images even in low light. That's what the company manufactures. They also manufacture optical domes. And what are they used in? They are used in missiles to sight the targets very efficiently, very effectively. And the third one, they also manufacture ultra high precision components to be used in a gyroscope. Now, what is this gyroscope? In simple words, it just helps to determine the positional accuracy, right? Second one, they also manufacture defense electronics equipments. Now, if you look at all these three images, in simple words, I'll quickly tell you, if you have watched that movie, Ghazi Attack, in that you might have seen that inside the submarine, there are lots of computers and all that. So you can imagine those computers have to sustain so much pressure at negative pressure, or it's basically a very adverse, very harsh environmental condition. So that these computers can also sustain in that pressure, in that harsh environment, they have to have some nice technology and some nice hardware or whatever. That's what the components is what the company makes. The third one is heavy engineering for defense. Now, again, if you have a look at these, they manufacture these metal tubes, flow forming machines, and even racks and cabinets and consoles. Now, why this last point? Now, you can imagine some high, very heavyweight machinery has to be mounted on top of something. Now, you can imagine if that cabinet is made of plastic. Now what will happen? It will just crack down, right? So they also make these very sturdy cabinets. And the last one is EMP protection solutions. Now you remember the pre-bumper, that small mosquito. That was not a mosquito. That was a drone which was very ready to attack me. So what did that drone do? In fact, the drone was used to attack my machine, you can say, which had some electromagnetic waves and all that. So if I wanted to protect my machine, I could have kept that machine in the second image, that is an EMP proof rack and cabinet. So basically it's a cabinet which protects, which saves an equipment from any electromagnetic attack. Okay, so I hope you understood what happened in the first part of the video. And last one, the company also makes niche technologies wherein they have some large deployable antennas. Again, recall Mission Mangal. So many Bollywood movies, they teach us so many things, right? Mission Mangal, you can remember that once the spaceship lands on, let's say, Mars, then can you recall that some antennas come outside that spaceship? So all these deployable antennas up to 18 meters for space applications is what the company makes. They also make CFRP. They also make avionics suits or glass cockpits. My God. And also the last one, which is capsule size drones. Now, at least I hope with so much of explanation, you have at least understood what does the company do. Now, let's try and understand why defense is very important for a country like India. Have a look at our map. We share our land border with 7 other countries and we are also bound by Arabian Sea in the west and Bay of Bengal in the east. And out of these 7 countries also, we don't have very nice relationship with 2 countries. No need for me to tell the names. So these are the external threats. Do we also have some internal threats within our country? Answer is unfortunately yes. So I hope you have understood why defense is of utmost importance for a country like India. So let's go ahead with the defense spending in India. Out of the total budgetary spend, 14-17% allocation is given only and only for the defense sector. Now let's try and understand how has the defense budget grown over the years. If you can see, from financial year 2017 to financial year 2022, the defense budget has continuously been in the growing trend. In FY17, it was around $46 billion, and in FY22, it's around $64 billion. Moving ahead with what are the government ambitions with respect to defense and space. First, we'll focus only on defense. If you see at this carefully, we have a modernization program for what? For Army, for Navy, and for Indian Air Force. So, all these parts, not only modernization, but also increasing more and more manufacture of our existing systems also, all these things come up under what? Atmanirbhar Bharat Initiative. Right. So, this is about how the government is really ambitious with defense. Going on with the next one, it's about defense offset concept. So, I'll try and explain this defense offset concept with the help of a very simple example. Have a look at this. What is this? This is, assume, HAL light combat helicopter. Now, assume that we are going to import this helicopter from some country. Okay. Now, what contract do we make with this country is that we will import this helicopter. Agreed. But what we will do is that almost, let's say, 30% of the components will be made in India. Okay, you have to use those components which are made in our country. 30%, 40% depends on each and every agreement. Okay, now if that country says no, we'll not do that, then we say either you do this or you transfer the technology that you have used to manufacture that helicopter. So I think this is a nice barter kind of a thing that we are trying to do, that is named as a defense offset, right? Moving on with the next point, this was about defense imports. Let's go on with defense export. Have the defense exports also grown? Yes, very well. They've grown from 2014-15 to 2018-19, and then you can see there's a drop in the last 2 years, 2020 and 2021. Why? Reason is very simple. Corona. There were a lot of disruptions in the supply chain. But with easing out of Corona, I'm sure these will surely ease out. So I hope you have understood how the overall budgetary allocation for the defense sector is growing very nicely and steadily. But who will be happy with this? It'll be a company like Paras, right? When will I be happy? I will be happy if the number of likes also goes on increasing, not steadily, at a rapid pace. So what do you have to do? Just pause the video, hit the like button, and then play the video. So let's start with the space industry. You still want some more on defense industry? Chalo, okay. Have a look at this chart then. This chart talks about the forecast of the defense industry. Till now, we are talking about what has happened in the past or till date. Now, this chart talks about the forecast of the defense sector. If you can see very clearly from, if I'm talking about 2022, currently the defense industry is around $3,000 million, and this is expected to grow till almost $15,000 million by what? 2031. So is there a good growth expected in this entire defense industry? Yes. Is it good for the company? Yes, obviously, right? With this base thing, now let's move on with the space industry. Now, you only tell me, if I'm talking about space, which is the first thing that comes to your mind? ISRO, right? Now, tell me, logically, if ISRO is increasing the spending on the space missions, then is it going to be a good sign for the company or bad sign? Obviously, good sign. Why? This company, Paras, they make certain equipments which are going to be used in the space missions, right? So now let's have a look at what are the expenditure forecasts for ISRO. So if I'm starting with 2020-21, you can see from 2021 to forecasted 2026-27 figures, it's showing a nice and steady growth. Is it like a very high growth? No, it's a slow and steady growth. Okay, for that we need to understand whether ISRO has any goals for the coming projects. So these are few of their coming projects. They're planning for a unified launch vehicle. They're planning for human space flight, which is Gaganyaan 2022. They're also planning for solar space mission and few others, right? Is government also playing an important role in this? Answer is obviously yes. What government is trying to do is they're trying to have a level playing field for the private players as well as public players. Now you can imagine that if this entire space of space, this entire space of space industry was allowed only for public sector companies, then private players like Paras would not have been able to enter the competition. Is government banning them? No. In fact, government is encouraging a proper level playing field for both these sectors. Well, this entity has a history of almost 40 years. It started way back in 1979 with the name of Messrs. Paras Engineering Company, which was like a sole proprietary concern. In 2009, it was renamed as Paras Flow Form Engineering Company and it was incorporated as a company. In 2015, the name was changed to Paras Defense and Space Technologies Limited, which is the current name of the company. Now, let's go to the order book of this company. Why order book is important for this one? Let's understand. See, the company makes engineering components and generally to fulfill these orders, it takes a longer time, generally more than a year. So, for such companies, typically order book is surely to be analyzed. What is their order book? If I'm talking about the total value, it's 3049 million rupees. Now, if I also compare this 3000 odd million rupees of order book with the FY21 revenue, FY21 revenue is almost 1433 million rupees. In simple words, their order book is almost twice or more than twice of their current revenue. We always say that in such a case, we would say that the company has a 2 years of order book. Okay. Now, let's talk about individual split. If you check for defense and space optics, the order value is very high, but the number of orders is comparatively less. But for defense, electronics and EMP protection solutions, the value is comparatively less, but the orders are comparatively more. So, value-wise, the first one is important. The volume-wise, second one is important, right? Going ahead with customers, which all customers do they have? Let us split into domestic and international. For domestic, they have very renowned customers like Bharat Electronic Limited, Hindustan Aeronautic Limited and Tata Consultancy Services and of course few more. If I'm talking about international customers, their international customers are from countries like Belgium, Israel and South Korea. Moving ahead with the last part for company details, which is the risks related to the company. Now, what could be the risks? If I'm talking about their revenue, more than 50%, to be precise, 50.84% of their revenue comes from government entities. Now, you can imagine, if government entities stop giving them orders, can I say there can be a big dent to their revenue? Answer is yes, right? Second, now, there can be one more point why government can say, no, we don't want to give you orders. Why? There was one more point which I found in the Red Herring Prospectus, which talks about cyber attacks in past. In October 2019, companies' emails were tapped, because of which company was defrauded for an amount of 23,376 pounds. Now you can imagine, if such things occur and reoccur, could there be a chance that government might give them lesser contracts? Yes, this is a potential risk I'm talking about. And last risk I would want to highlight is about the negative cash flows which were there in the past. Now if you have a look at this chart, their operating cash flows have turned from 120 million negative to 42.85 million rupees, which is in a positive one. So risk is that there were negative cash flows, but now at least they have turned into positive cash flows. Let's talk about the key financial highlights now. If you can see that their revenue has been decreasing and it has dropped at a CAGR, negative CAGR, of 3.65%. Profit has also decreased at a CAGR of 8.78%. So of course it's a minus 8.78%, right? EPS has also decreased from 6.72 in 2019 to 5.55 in 2021. So I'm sure by now you are like, wow, amazing, what amazing industry, what is, everything is amazing. And now this is the anticlimax. Okay, so the financials are not that rocking, to be honest. At least is there some positive point? Yes, their long-term debt, they have substantially reduced as compared to the previous years. Also, one more additional point is that in 2019-20, they issued a bonus equity in the share of 1:4, means one bonus share was given for every 4 shares held. Coming to the IPO details, as of now, when I'm shooting the video on Thursday, I just have very limited information about the company. The opening date is 21st September, closing date is 23rd September, and expected listing date is 1st of October. As and how I get more details about what is the price band, the minimum order quantity and few more details, whenever I get it, I'm going to post it in my Telegram channel. So if you want, you can also go to the Telegram channel, join it. Of course, it's free of cost, right? Last point is about the objects of the issue. It's not very special. They're going to use these funds raised from the IPO for capital expenditure requirements, for working capital requirements, for repaying some loans and some general corporate purposes, right? Now, just one last point before I wind up. What could be the expected price of the issue? As when the video is released, by then at least the price will be anyways released. But what is my expectation? Have a look at this chart. You'll be able to understand at what rate the company has done a pre-placement of their shares. The pre-placement, which happens in a private as a private placement, in the month of March, they did this allotment at 125 rupees per share. Same rate was did take place in April 26 as well. And on 29th July, there was one more allotment which happened at 160 rupees per share. So is there a chance that the IPO will be offered at a price higher than 160? I personally believe yes. And what I used just now is nothing but a CTM, which is a comparable transaction method. And the grand finale question, whether I'm going to apply for this issue or not. Answer for this question is going to come up on the live stream on 23rd at 11 a.m. So don't forget to join this live stream. I hope you have enjoyed this video. Share it with your friends and family members. Till then, take care. Jai Hind and bye-bye.